Hi there, I'm Fish and welcome to the Funny Farm Kitchen Garden.
In 1988, when I left Marillion, I had a big decision to make. I was in a house in Buckinghamshire with a very big mortgage and I was going to have to move somewhere. And my then wife and I looked at places down in Bath and Bristol. We thought about Birmingham, and at the end of the day, I decided that the best place I could come to was back up to Scotland. I didn't want to hang about London, and I really needed to kind of extricate myself from that entire scene. And I kind of refined myself in a way. And my mum and dad were looking for places. I'd asked them to just have a look about and see if they could find anywhere. And they found the house, the main house at Spittle Rig Farm, were a little package of land with it. And I saw it and thought it was absolutely brilliant. My then wife didn't, and I remember she being a Berlin, an ex-Berlin citizen. I remember her being in tears in the drive when she saw the place, because she just couldn't see it, whereas I saw the place, right? And one of the things that drove the decision to take on this property was the fact that when I was in Marillion, we used to spend a fortune on rehearsals and on, for residential writing and everything. We never agreed to get a place. And I thought, if I'm going to go solo and I'm going to start a new band and I'm going to get a career off and running, I need to cut a lot of those costs back. And one of the obvious things I had to do was to find a property where I had enough space, residential space, to bring musicians in, to put them up, to have a writing room and things. So we had a base, you know, and this place fitted the bill perfectly. At the time, it was the main house, which was habitable, although needed a lot of work done to it. And there was a bunch of outbuildings and a big patch of land. And I think it was about a third of an acre or something. But the thing that was the most attractive was were the outbuildings. And where we are, we're actually at on the farm itself now, this was really, it was one of three buildings that were actually, as I said, habitable. But it was what became the studio was what really, I just went, this is where I can work.
And then we'll walk through to the studio from the house. As you can hear in the background, there's the band rehearsing. We've been here a week and this is the first time.
The outbuilding used to be a party room for the family. It was when the family that owned this place, the Hendersons, when the kids grew up a little bit, they would move out to this outbuilding and they used to have parties in there and stuff like that. And I just saw it as a perfect writing room. And it had to become a demo studio. I had to be able to do demos there. And we kind of outfitted it in a very kind of simplistic way. And that was where we wrote Vigil. Really, I mean, the material that I'd started writing with Mickey Simmons, we really moved it on, and Mickey came up to join me with his wife, Sarah, and they lived here for quite a long time. The other buildings that we had, there was two sheds here that are kind of to the left of me, and the sheds were perfect because I could put my flight cases in there, I could put my equipment in there.
Now we're outside at the back of the farm, to the greenhouse. And we move round to the cage where we store all the empty cases while rehearsing. Here we have our wardrobe cases on the right and some drum cases.
Mm-hmm. it was a great space. The garden was pretty intimidating. I mean, at school I was great at biology. It was, ironically, it was like history, English and biology were my three best subjects. And when I left school, I went into the Forestry Commission via Midlothian Council, where I worked in the gardens for the summer period, as students always did. But, you know, I worked in genetics for a year with the Forestry Commission. Then I went up to Spearmouth Forest, away up in northeast Scotland, and I worked in a wood up there, where it was like cutting and dealing with, I was planting and working on fences and drains and all sorts of stuff, because I was actually in the process of developing a forestry career where I was aimed at Newton Rigg College in Penrith. And I ended up down in Newton Rigg and did a year there on an OND course. And there I was again studying botany and all sorts of things that were forestry associated. And when I went into the middle year, out of this three-year course, I ended up in Bow Hill Estate down in the Borders. And again, you know, I was wrapped up in what I see as the basis of gardening. I mean, nobody in my family had ever been particularly interested in gardening. I mean, my mum even says that now. She goes, I don't know where you got this from. Because, you know, there was minor vegetable plots and things, you know, when I was a kid. But, I mean, there was no gardening of any notice. And at Gerrard's Cross, when I was there in the late 80s, and, you know, when I was coming off tours, I had this idea to try and create a garden, which never happened. And as I said, I ended up here and had a third of an acre to deal with. And I had really no idea what to do with it. Grass, you cut, but I mean, vegetables, nah. This huge area garden, I had no real idea what to do. We took on a gardener for a while, but I didn't know what to say, do this. And I thought I'd taken on somebody that knew a little bit about gardening. He didn't. I remember it was like in the first year we were here, we put tatties in, easy peasy. And he also planted a bunch of courgettes. And I thought, oh, great, courgettes. Yeah, I've eaten those things in restaurants, right? So he put in, it must have been about 100 courgette plants down by the hedge. And these things started to grow. And then you realise that courgettes, like, there's not very much you can do with courgettes. And the thing was, I always remember, because we had the big shed, which we had a tractor in it, because I got a tractor off Andy Field, my production manager, and he'd renovated this ancient Massey Ferguson tractor. And I bought it off him, and he brought it up in a trailer, and it ended up in the big shed.
Oh, and there is one. And there it is, and there he is. And he's got the flight case on the back. Now, if we keep really quiet, he won't notice us.
But the big shed was where we stored the vegetables, and as these courgettes grew, we were going, oh, courgettes, oh, that's great. And then you're thinking you're picking all these courgettes off, and then you'd open up a leaf, and then you find these marrows, and it was a bit like Invasion of the Body Snatchers. There was these huge pods, and we went, oh, we'll keep them, we'll store them. Somebody's bound to want them. And we had this massive shed that had this old Massey Ferguson tractor in it. And it had marrows, like hundreds and hundreds of marrows. And like I said, you could expect Donald Sutherland to walk in, you know, or people coming in to carry them to the houses so they could, you know, create aliens. And we tried selling them to local restaurants. They go, no, we're okay. But that was the garden. We didn't know what to do. I stuck in a lot of plants, and there's quite a few trees. And I think the two most significant trees that are in the grounds of the old house, the old main house, as my then manager, John Kavanagh, he gave us, because my wife is German, I'm Scottish, there's an Austrian pine and a Scots pine that were planted in the front garden of the house. And I always realise how long I've been here by looking at the size of those trees.
So this area was, when I lived in the old house, this was the front, right? And it took me a while to get used to calling this the back garden, right? But this was kind of like where you, with the studio, there was the, there was an office, and we had the two recording booths at the doors that came out to this part of the garden. But this area here, you can tell from the photographs, it was basically all the subsoil and the crap that they basically dug out to make the founds for the studio. And I knew nothing about it. I mean, when I bought the house in 1989, I really knew nothing about gardening. I knew nothing. I had ideas, and gardens are like houses. Everybody wants a big garden, everybody wants a big house, but people forget about just how much work you've got to put into it, and it is incredibly daunting. And originally, when I bought this place, I owned this entire area, right? And I had no idea what to do in it. But when I moved into the studio in 2001, right, I was left with the back garden. And this pile here, as I said, came from all the subsoil and the founds from the founds of the studio. And I didn't realise it was just such crap soil. And I just built it up, and I was like, I'll build a ridge and we'll grow plants in it. Not thinking anything about the soil type or anything at all. And it was rubbish. And bit by bit, the wall was built. There was a small pond there. And this is one of the big projects for this year, right? We call it the Peter Pan Pond because you can just make out Peter in the back. And I actually, I bought the figure ages ago, and I actually did a thing on I think it was STV, and it was like, they came around my garden. I said, oh, see the Peter Pan thing. And some old folks home way down the west coast of Scotland got in touch and accused me of stealing their Peter Pan. We used to have one just like that. I said, well, this made, this came out of a factory, but you've stolen a Peter Pan. And they got really uptight about it. But anyway, this pond, when it was built, it's one of the problems I've always had with this garden, is you leave people to do things and you've got to go away and tour, or you're carried away by things. And when the pond was built, I said to the guy, build the surround, put the, what is a prefabricated pond in it, a kind of plastic fiberglass pond, put it in and build it around and build it up bit by bit and pack it and put water in it so the whole thing sits. And did he do that? Did he? Right? And he basically built the whole wall up, put the pond in and tried to fill it all at the back. And he put sand in, so when the pond fills up or filled up, it water come out the side and it washed away all the sand. And I'm dreading doing this because there's all these frogs come here every year, and there's all the gaps at the back of the pond now because the whole pond's basically dropped about 6 inches on that side. So the water all scoots in there and it carries all the frogs with it. And I'm dreading going in here because I'm sure there's a massive frog graveyard at the bottom of that, or rats, right? And in there, because it's like, I've not done anything, it's not been aerated, there's been nothing done, there's some evil shit down the bottom of that pond, and I've got to go in it. Because what I've got to do is strip the edge, and I want to put a pond liner inside the pond, so that it brings up all the height and basically balances the thing off and put all the slabs back. But it means emptying that, right? And it could be a fun job in the summer, or it might just be really scary. But that is one of the big things. I've had fish in there, and I gave up because every now and again a heron would come down and just empty the pond of fish. And the last time I had fish in it, there was about, I think, 13, 14 in the pond. And basically in a day, the heron took them, and that was with a net on the top. And what happened was the grass grew up and lifted the net up, and the heron came down, landed there, and just, it was like a little window, and it just went bang, 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 and took every one of the fish out. But that is a big project for this year.
My main focus was really on where we were living, and where I'm sitting now, that is south. It's a brilliant aspect, right? But back then, in the early 90s, this part of the garden wasn't used at all. This was just the sheds. There was a great big blank canvas on this side of the house, because everything that was getting planted, all the shrubs that were going in, were always round about the residential section. And we carried on. I didn't really get that much into garden in the 90s by any stretch of the imagination. And it wasn't really until 2000 when I ran into some severe financial difficulty, and my marriage was collapsing. My daughter Tara had been born. She was coming up to She was a bit, she was 10-year-old when everything kind of went pop. And in 2001, I had to sell the main house. My wife had left and gone to Berlin. And I was left with the main house and the residential block. And I call it the residential block because the studio was built in basically 1990. Having the independence, having my own studio here, meant that I could survive and create. And so in 1990, I was in the middle of extricating myself from Marillion, which involved a legal battle, fighting EMI on the legal battle that came out of the failed discussions on contract. And I was trying to keep everything together in my solo career. It was a very, very difficult time. And it had a lot to do with eventually what happened in 2001. It had consequences. But I followed it through, built the studio, built the residential block, and moved on it. And I had my freedom. And I am so glad I did.
Back in the days when the studio was up and running, this was a football pitch. And I had I was given a full set of goals for my birthday one time. And we had the goal set up, and Mickey Simmons and Robin Bolt and I used to play football here all the time. And that was when the wall was up. And but after I knocked the wall down, that became the hosta bed, and it's a beautiful area for hostas. And this one, it's just been building beds for flowers all the time. Another problem was that, as I said, all the spoils and the subsoil that came from the studio was all launched onto the Heartbreak Ridge. And the rest, I stupidly turned around when they said, oh, what are we going to do with it? And I said, oh, well, it's going to cost you a fortune for trucks. So I said, oh, we'll just spread it down here. So we spread all this really crappy subsoil all over what was a brilliant piece of vegetable garden. And I regret it. And I've been struggling with it ever since. And it's meant that the lawn here is sitting on clay, because you go 3 feet down here and it's just solid clay. And we've got drainage issues here, et cetera, which is why I put the raised beds in. That's why all these raised beds were built. That's called the 50 pence bed. That got ruined in one of the storms last year. I was growing strawberries there last year, and then everything kind of collapsed, and it's another on the to-do list. But I don't know what I'm going to do here. I've got to work it out, whether I'm going to keep strawberries there or whatever. And this is called the Longshanks bed, named after Steve Vances. And Steve got the name Longshanks a long time ago. And again, it was a raised bed to put the soil in and keep it above the clay and all the rest of it. And the whole thing was just constructed using paving slabs stuck on their edge in concrete. And but all this was just, you know, back in when I moved in here in 89, there was nothing here at all. So, the slope was a lot softer. And where the orchard is, the orchard was put in 2009. But the area was levelled in 2006. Because at the time I was going to get married in the garden on a foolish romantic notion. And we levelled the whole thing off. And again, we ran into all the problems with the clay. So where the apple trees are, there's a lot of clay. But down that far end, the soil gets a lot better. But you can see from the bottom of the hedge down the height that the garden was taken down to make that level. So we could put up a huge marquee tent. And what we did have was a brilliant album launch party for 13 Star. And after it was levelled, in the following year, I decided to put a big orchard in. So there's, I think it's about 40 trees, all different types. But again, this is another huge piece of work, because I've got to go in and prune these trees because they've been left for far too long. And you can see some of them need staked up. There's a couple have got missing. There's a badly damaged something or other. I've got a plan. I don't know what they all are. I'm rubbish with names of plants. I stick things in the ground, I completely forget what they are. But the orchard needs a lot of tender, loving care. And between my orchard and the orchard that belongs to one of the neighbours, there's an espaliered apple hedge, which is a nightmare. And it should be all layered and running along horizontally, but if you don't keep your eye on it, it just goes straight up. And that's another thing. But as I said, it's like a big garden. It's like, you know, everyone goes, oh, get a big garden, be great. But it's just, the work is immense. And today, we did the hedge.
Abound on the dark road to city life, heading for coffee bars, singing along to the songs on the radio.
In 2001, when it all went kaboom and I had to sell the house and sell the residential block, I kept the studio. I knew I had to keep my main place of work. And basically, in 2001, the studio was split away from the main house and I moved into it as a single man and a single divorced man. And I was left with this whole area that nothing had been done to, because all the main work on the gardens and stuff had all been done on the residential side, which was now the old main house. And now I had this area. And in 2001, I was in pretty bad mental shape. You know, I'd just got divorced. I was on the verge of financial ruin. My daughter was in Berlin with my then ex-wife, and I was living here in this place, in a studio. And this French window, for example, wasn't there in 2001. This was all built bit by bit, and over the years it has been turned, and the studio has become a residential dwelling. When I moved in, and the stress of dealing with that entire situation, I used to go to sleep at night and I would design a garden. And that is what kept me sane, was actually going to bed at night and imagining how it would develop, the planning, the organisation of it all. And in my head, the Funny Farm Kitchen Garden was born, right? And as I said, it kept my sanity. The big sheds that had been the place where we kept the equipment, when we were trying to sell the property, because we did try to sell the studio with everything at the time, and nobody wanted it, it was too big. They loved the house, they loved the studio, but nobody could see what to do with it, with the entire kind of property. And at the end of the 90s, my production manager, one of my best mates, Yatta, came up and we knocked down the sheds. We dropped the sheds to try and make the property more attractive, right? To get rid of the stuff that, you know, people were gonna go, what were we gonna do with that? And so when we knocked down the sheds, I'd actually kept a lot of the stone, all the old stone. And we'd parked it all. And I did think about, well, if I move, I'll keep the stone or whatever, or people might want it. But what happened was that all the stone from those old sheds, we kind of brought it together. And that was used to build the first of the raised bed sections, which is really the kitchen garden. And what I wanted to do was, because the studio had been built in the 1990s, I wanted to try and make it feel old and to give it a bit of character. And I thought, if I use all the old stone from the original sheds, that it would look like the footprint of like a ruined village or a ruined farmstead, and like I said, give it a lot of character, and it worked so well. But the whole thing has just been developed over the years. The area where the sheds were, it became a lawn. But as I said, the aspect changed, and it was the It was great feng shui, because what I had was southern aspect and the west. So when the sun comes up in the morning, it basically traverses the sky and throws sunshine all over the front raised beds and all over the kitchen garden, and it sets obviously across in the west. So it's been, you know, it was a perfect situation. It was a perfect place to build the new garden and re-establish myself. And one of the problems that we have with filming when we do anything on the front is that because I have to stay in the sunlight so we don't get shadows crossing my face like that. No. But that's the beauty of having the southern aspect. In 1990, when we started to build the studio, it was a major piece of construction, because what I did was I kept the original building which was the old party room stroke where the prisoners of war were kept, right? And it was an interesting wee story on the side of that, because I was told that the farmer who originally owned this place, right? Because there used to be two farms here. There was Uxton Rig, which is to the north, and Spittle Rig. And they were joined together in 1932. But back then, the farmer was seemingly... he had a bit of a drink problem. Maybe he was a singer in a rock and roll band. But the story was that the farmer used to go down to Haddington. He used to go down the pub and get his carryouts. And he had the pony and trap that would take him down. And back in those days, to get to Haddington, you went down the road and down by Lethem, and it was quite a long journey. But seemingly, he used to get steaming in the pub and then come back with these big carryouts and things and have parties up here. And there was a story that, you know, he used to put all the bottles in the walls, right? And I was told this before we built the studio. And lo and behold, the only existing wall from that original building, which was the only stone wall, when we actually constructed the studio and opened it up, we found out that inside the wall there were all these old broken champagne bottles and whiskey bottles, and therefore, you know, the farm myth was actually, or the farm legend was a fact. And it was interesting to see all these old bottles, and I just went, it's a sign. And I'm still putting bottles in now. Every wall we build, we put bottles in. It's recycling. But back then, in 1990, when we did it, it was the original building. But what is now my TV room, where I do all the Fish and Fridays from, right? That was built, and where that room, which is immediately on my right, that used to be the old drying green. And where I'm sitting now was one of the sheds.
So, when this extension was put on, which was a bathroom and stuff, we had to kind of steal a bit of area. And this is the last surviving piece of the original shed wall. And this thing is a feeding trough. And it was left when I moved into the house. And I never knew what to do with it. And it wasn't until a little later I went, small pond. And it's brilliant because we've got all the bird feeders here, which are marvellous. And the birds go in the water, and it's sometimes quite calming watching blackbirds bathe. But these are my blueberries. Some of these are going to the Outlander set at some point for one of their film sets. And what I'm standing in now was originally the two sheds, and underneath there is basically mainly concrete, and there's only about 4 inches, 5 inches of soil in it. And rather than rip all the concrete up, which was going to be a huge undertaking, I decided to go for raised beds, and I put these in again around about 2009, and it's all recycled plastic, and the design's not that great. It's like meter blocks, and they're held on the cross by there's cross ties in between the meter blocks underneath the soil, and basically they've just rusted, and all the sides are failing. And this is the big project. I don't know when I'm going to get this done, but the idea is to put 3 12 meter long by about 1.5 meter wide raised beds that are made out of larch that are sitting there about that height, which means that, you know, as I move into my old age gracefully, I can sit there on the side and weed and do all my bits and pieces without doing my backing. But to put the 3 12-metre beds here is a huge thing, because I've got to basically empty all these, clear it all up, put the beds down, and I've got plans that I'll explain more on another shoot about what I really want to do here. But it's been in the back of my head. I used to spend a lot of time falling asleep in the bunk and tour buses trying to work out what I'm going to do here. But I mean, the idea is to put big raised beds with irrigation systems and all the rest of it. But I don't have to do it. I have to plan it out around what I'm putting in the ground, because I'm going to have to do without the growing medium for at least 4 months, you know, to get the new raised beds put in. But the whiskey barrels, these half whiskey barrels, have been great, because I can shift things in and out of there. But this is the main growing area of the funny farm. And the cabin was put in when my mum moved into the house in 2019. We didn't have any spare rooms, so my mum took our room, and we had to build something for Steve Vance's to stay in, because he used to live in a tent in the orchard, and he complained rather a lot. So we got this cabin. It came from Estonia for a film called Palmico, and it's affectionately known as the backstage area, and it's a great place just to like chill out and take in the garden, basically. The font, that originally came from St Nicholas Church in Dalkeith, and my dad gave it to me. It used to be in the old garden down in Glebe Street in Dalkeith, and it's very proud of that, actually. It's but it's weird. It goes red. And I'm wondering whether it's a satanic thing. Satan's font. But this area here has just been getting developed in the last 3 months, 4 months. I mean, I find it strange when I look at these trees. It's like I planted that birch way back when I first moved here. And the same with it's a Himalayan rowan, I think it is. And behind you, that I planted. You get an idea of like how long I've actually been here. But this is all set up for the big 12-metre beds. And it should look spectacular when it's done, but it's a massive undertaking. But just physically moving all the soil and clearing this whole area, it's going to take some careful planning, and it's going to take a lot of hens. Huh? But this wisteria came from the film set of The Rig. It was given to me by my future son-in-law, and that is also destined for pruning. But this is one of my favourite parts, right? And I like the idea of gardens, how it's all different areas, and you move from one to the other, and they've got different feels and vibes. And this part here, we've had to put a bathroom in, like a proper bath in. So my mum has got a walk-in shower and stuff. And when I did this, it was so close to my neighbour's house, and they put ventilation ports at the bottom of the wall, and I couldn't cover them up, and I couldn't go down in case I endangered the wall on the side. So I came up with this idea to put basically a ramped area, which so underneath that it's all hollow, which means the ventilation bits work. And even more so, we call it this little track that goes all around, we call it Le Mum. It's not Le Mon, it's Le Mum. And the idea is that my mum can come out with her walker and go all the way around the garden and in the front door, and all cut us all on the one level. But this is what's called the Princess's Garden. Our very own outside toilet. But I love this area. And this one, when they put the extension in, this looked like Passchendaele. It looked like the Highwood in 1918. And it was just a mess. And there's always been a pond here. And I had to redesign all this again to accommodate the different levels and the drains and stuff. And again, this was the original Peter Pan pond. This used to be one around the front, and it's been recycled and it's been brought in here. But it gets manky. That's a bit more like it. But yeah, so it's all grasses and ferns, and it was really designed as, again, a chill space. And because my mum is in the room there, so when it's sunny, she can come out, sit on the bench, hear the water, and it's warm. It's very together. And it's a really relaxing place. I saw the ferns and the bamboos. I put the new bird boxes up just a couple of months ago. And it's a lot of shade-loving plants, but I love this area. And I've got my office on the other side of the window, so in the summer, I can open up my own window and I can hear the water while I'm working at the desk. Again, there's so much work. This has all got to be cleared out and stuff, and that's why there's a skip outside. There's always a skip outside my house.
When I built the studio in 1990, this building cost about, I think the build was about £300,000, which took in all the acoustic detail. I mean, the insulation that was in this building, all the acoustic panelling that was put in, the control room, you know, it was highly expensive. And at the time, I mean, it put me behind the eight ball. And by 2001, when we were, well, by the late 90s, when we were trying to sell this property, it was a concrete albatross around my neck. But now, you know, today, right, you know, if I hadn't taken that pain back then, right, I wouldn't have this place. And this is the best place I've ever lived in my life. The vibe of this. And there's an interesting wee story that goes along with it. Because back in the late 90s, you know, I mean, I'll be open. I mean, I was about 900 grand in debt. It was horrific. And the way my dad had brought me up, you know, I mean, people were saying, you just go bankrupt and run it, you know. And I want to try and fight my way out of it, which is why I had to sell the main house, which was sold together with the residential block. And all I kept was the bit that I'd bit in 1990. But in the 90s, when I was looking at the original record company, which was the Dick Brothers Record Company, I was desperate. I was like, when you're desperate, you always do tarot. Contact mediums. And I was introduced by a friend in Switzerland to this medium who lived in Scotland, between Scotland and Switzerland. And he came down and we did, what do you call it, not a seance, but like a reading, right? And we did it in the room where my mother is currently staying, and what was back then was the playroom, right? Or it was the band room, and it was next to the control room, and it was like where the bands could watch TV in between sessions and stuff like that. And we did the reading in there, and without going into a lot of detail about it all, because there was a lot of things happening in that, but one of the things he said was, I was asking him about the house and what we should do, and you know. And he said to me, he said, this is your spiritual home. And I said, this place is where you should be. You fit with this place, right? And at the time, it didn't make sense. And I'm kind of going, is he saying that I shouldn't sell the farm? And like, am I making a really bad decision to leave Spittlerig and stuff? Because, I mean, I was faced with having to move completely out of East Lothian. You know, if it all went down, I was going to be out of this county, which I didn't want to leave because I love East Lothian, right? And I was sitting in that place, and he's going, you know, this is where your soul is. This is where you're meant to be. And didn't make sense. Then it makes sense now, because I was sitting in the room that would eventually become our bedroom, and you know, in the last 3 years, my mum's room. So what he was referring to was basically the studio. It's kind of the area where it's my spiritual home, because I don't feel attached to the old parts of the property that I sold off. I've got no kind of real emotional attachment, which is kind of really strange, considering that, you know, my daughter Tara was brought up there. I lived in there for, you know, 12 years. And but you know, when I've been in there to visit the neighbours at New Year or whatever, you know, I don't feel any kind of attachment. There's no. It's strange, but here, you know, I love it. And Simona, you know, and Simona and I got married in 2017. We've been together now for 11 years, and you know, but she loves this place, and we really feel it's. You know, it's such a soulful place, and the garden. And I think, as I said, with the history of the garden coming from being originally a herb garden, vegetable garden, because the Henderson family, who used to own all this property, who still own the rest of the farm, right? Old Mrs. Henderson, as I said, was into holistic gardening and planting seed at moonlight in a full moon and organic garden, because all she actually opened, or the Hendersons opened up majorly down to, I think her name was Janet Henderson. They opened up the Henderson Salad Bar, which was the first ever vegetarian restaurant in Edinburgh, and that was in 1963, I think, or in the early 60s. And all the vegetables that went to the Henderson's vegetarian restaurant, the salad bar, whatever, came from this farm. And when I started to redo the garden, when I started to take an interest and develop the garden again, I just feel like I'm taking over a kind of legacy in a way. And I don't mean in a family legacy, but, you know, just in the state of the farm. Because I love the idea where, when people talk about owning land, and something that was said to me a while back, and it's always rung true, is that you never actually own land. All you are is just the caretaker. During your time on this planet, you're the caretaker, right? You're just looking on it to pass it on to the next caretaker. And that's the way I look on the whole garden and this area of the farm that I look after, and trying to beautify it, grow it, keep positive energies within it, and develop it. And yeah, that's what I am. I'm the caretaker of this place. You know, I don't own it. I'm just the caretaker. And eventually, you know, when I slip off my mortal coil, hopefully somebody will take on this place. And it's really weird, because my daughter Tara was never into gardening. She was never interested in it. But in the last 2-3 years, she's really developed an interest. And she's more involved with this place now than she ever was when she was younger. And, you know, maybe that's what happens. I mean, maybe this place will be, you know, Tara will become the next caretaker. But for the moment, you know, my wife Simone and I mean, you know, we love this place. I mean, it really feels soulful, you know, and, you know, and we love it, absolutely love it.
Now get off my bloody land.